A new year means new activities around Warwick, and we've got the highlights for you in the Valley. Hello and welcome back to In the Valley. I'm your host, Ryan DiCostanzo. 2018 has been busy within the community. A lot has been happening down in Warwick ever since the new year kicked off. Because of this, we met up with the Warwick Valley Historical Society at Sanfordville Elementary School to learn about their presentation of traveling trunks.
Into something like this. This is an old barn beam. This is about 200.
As many of you probably know, young kids are very active. In a situation where they have to learn, it can be difficult to control their energy. The Warwick Historical Society realized this, using it to their advantage. The Traveling Trunks program gives young students an opportunity to get a hands-on look at how people lived many years ago.
We can see the excitement in the kids' faces. They really like to learn, touch things, feel things, so almost all the things that the Traveling Trunks program provides to the Warwick schools are hands-on items.
This learning method engages the students utilizing their energy into something productive. The hands-on approach for learning gives the students more of an insight into how people lived, allowing them to experience the artifacts.
Hands-on's the best. You know, I'm not the type of person that wants to just sit here and present. I hate looking at like PowerPoint presentations and sitting in the audience. I want to get my hands on things. I want to touch and feel and just get closer to the subject matter. Just make it more intimate.
That's because he made it with this thing.
In the end, the kids benefited from the hands-on look at the artifacts, giving them a better insight into how people lived many years ago.
In Warwick, down in the middle school, they recently hosted their annual event, Valentine's for Vets. Students had the opportunity to sit down, talk, and have breakfast with local veterans of the Warwick community to celebrate Valentine's Day.
For years and years, men and women alike have been serving our country and protecting our freedom. Children of this generation are not really aware of the severity of war, and it's unlikely that they will ever truly understand unless they enroll in the military. At Warwick Valley Middle School, the students and staff decided to turn this cliche around.
Valentine's for Vets has started as a grassroots just writing to veterans, and that was probably the early 90s when it began. And then it evolved into this wonderful breakfast.
Students in Miss Lane's home and career class made an abundant amount of food for veterans and children to enjoy. Miss Maynard and Mr. Misick got the wire choir and guitar club together.
As a disabled American veteran whose family fought in all the major engagements and wars in the 20th century, I feel it's extremely important that today's youth know America's history and know it thoroughly.
War can be a very terrifying thing. Many of the men and women have oxygen tanks, prosthetics, walkers, or can't even walk at all. But it was all for a good cause, to keep these children and America safe.
From us at In the Valley, we would like to extend a special thank you to all the men and women who are currently serving and those who have served for our country. Don't go away. Coming up next, we have Mayor Michael Newhard talking with us. So stay with us in the Valley.
There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had so many children, she didn't know what to do. She gave them some broth without any bread and kissed them all soundly.
Lights out.
Good night.
And put them to bed. Hunger is a story we can end. End it at feedingamerica.org.
Welcome back to In the Valley. I'm Ryan DiCostanzo. Joining us now is Village of Warwick Mayor Michael Newhard. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Ryan.
Mayor Newhard, you're well known in the community. What is it like to be the mayor?
Well, it's actually an honor, to be elected by your fellow citizens and neighbors, friends, and to represent them in a form of government, and but on an everyday basis, you know, as a leader, and you know, trying to make it a better community. It's challenging, and sometimes it's very difficult, mm-hmm. But mostly it's fun. It really is, you know, a great thing. It has been a great thing in my life.
Well, that's great to hear. Thank you for all you've done for the Warwick.
Thank you.
For a sustainable Warwick's mission is to protect the environment and reduce carbon emissions locally. Can you just give us an update on that?
Well, you know, Sustainable Warwick is a grassroots organization. It's a remarkable organization of men and women who really are dedicated to those ideals. What is fascinating to me is that Warwick has always had a history of that type of activity. And, you know, some of it stems from, especially in the past 25 years, where this community, not just the village, but the entire town, made a decision to preserve farmland.
Mm-hmm.
That unto itself was a remarkable event. And what it means is that there's a future for agriculture in this valley. And that, which is one of our largest businesses, is a very important thing to sustain. So we have that backbone of just the overall community wanting to do preservations of environment. And you know, not only is it farmland, but it's woodland and it's open space. So all those things, you know, are really important. Out of that, I believe this group emerged, and so they're, you know, on sort of hit the ground running, and they've been doing all sorts of activities to make Warwick a better, cleaner, safer environment.
Well, that's definitely great to hear. Now, if someone wants to get involved, how would they be able to do that?
There's a website, of course. Mm-hmm. Sustainable Warwick meets monthly, and I believe they meet at the town senior center. And so that's, you know, it's very easy to get in touch with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I would advise, I mean, the more young people that are involved, I think the better and stronger it will be, because the idea is really a kind of a legacy, and also to have as many young people involved to be able to pass that baton to. So I think that would be very important.
Now, going off the environment, mm-hmm. the winter weather has been all over the place lately. What has been the biggest challenge the village has been keeping?
You know, there are many challenges when the weather changes. You know, a village, as opposed to outside the village, which is the township, you know, the town-wide area, we have internal infrastructure. We have systems. We have a water system. We have a sewer system. And so those are all pipes underground. And when you have temperature fluctuations, they freeze. Often, in many cases, you know, they freeze and they'll break. And they don't always freeze, but if there's the right situation, they can freeze. And so water mains and sewer breaks are, you know, sort of par for the course during those periods of temperature fluctuation. But also there is snow removal, and that's a big deal, you know, especially in a busy downtown where, you know, businesses thrive. They need to have the streets clean. If you go into our community the day after a storm, usually we have already been up all night cleaning the main streets in the business district of all the snow. So even though Main Street is a state highway, we take care of all the snow that is left, which is near the sidewalks, and it mm-hmm. makes it hard for people to get out of their car and get onto the main street. We see that as a very important, critical thing to get done as immediately as possible so that business can continue to occur.
Well, that's great for like all the citizens of Warwick to be happy and be safe.
that's my goal.
So within the Warwick community and the businesses thriving, there's restaurants everywhere, but one of the landmark businesses yesterday's is looking to make a move.
Yes.
Can you provide any update on where that stands currently?
Well, it has been a kind of a year-long and somewhat contentious issue. And the reason being is that Yesterday's wants to move off of Main Street, the very central business district, to an outlying area, which is zoned commercial. It is something called a light industrial zone, and it's on Elm Street. And I'm sure, you know, you've seen articles and letters, and there's been a lot of frustration by the neighbors that surround the area. This is a 4-acre parcel. It's a very large parcel. that has been zoned that way, some form of commercial for the past 50 years. So it has always had that zoning. Mm-hmm. It's just that nothing has ever been there. I mean, it originally, historically, it was a train yard. So it was a machine shop. There was a lot of activity. It must have been very noisy in those days. Mm-hmm. But for the past 50 years, it's been pretty quiet, and it's been used as a parking lot for Country Chevy, but that's about it. But it's always had the potential to be something. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we're dealing with, is that potential. And recently, there was a planning board meeting where I think that it has been resolved that yesterdays will do many things that will make sure that the relationship with the neighborhood is better or stronger, in that he's removed the outdoor seating area. There's no outside speakers. There is, if there's any outdoor service that ends at 8 o'clock, he's changed his filter system, his exhaust system, fan system for the kitchen, so that it is much, much quieter. He's reduced the height of the poles, mm-hmm. so that they don't shed as much light. So those are all the things that come through a planning process. And that's the kind of, you know, what an applicant has to listen to. They have to listen to the planning board and to the neighbors. And that all came through a public hearing and through that process. Mm-hmm. And so that's where we are now. And I believe that, you know, there may be some more, you know, finishing touches, mm-hmm. but I think that the application at this point will probably move forward.
Okay. Now, are there any plans for a business that would take an open spot on Main Street?
Well, you know, there you go. You have now an open spot, and that happens all the time. I don't know what is planned to go there, but now we're talking probably a year, maybe a year okay. and a half from now. So it's hard to plan that far in advance. But I know that the owner of the property, which is the gentleman that owns the bookstore, mm-hmm. Has had many requests to move into the property. So,
okay.
So there, you know, it's property on Main Street or storefronts on Main Street are a premium, and people really want to. You know, what is interesting about our community is that we have an active downtown that's not just one Main Street. It's also side streets. It's mm-hmm. Spring Street and Railroad Avenue, and it's McEwen Street. And these side streets hold kind of incubator businesses, the entrepreneurs that are starting out. It could be, for example, Conscious Fork mm-hmm. started on McEwen Street in a little small storefront, which right now is the Cobbler. And so she grew out of that very quickly, and she decided, and there was an opening on Railroad Avenue, and she moved her business to Railroad Avenue to a much more, you know, upfront and larger space. So it's things like that that you see all the time, that you know, have kind of somebody starting out with a small business and a business idea, and they can be successful, and if they are successful, then they move to a larger venue on Main Street.
Well, that's great to hear. Yeah. Shifting topics, yes. The Albert Wisner Library was named one of the best small libraries. So it's a great resource for village residents. Are there any programs or events that you like to highlight?
Well, there are many, many, many events. Their programming is spectacular. Recently, the village kind of partnered with the library to enlarge their parking lot because they were landlocked. And so they have developed a portion of village property, which is parkland, to be a parking lot. And so it's open, it's a municipal lot, but it's used by the library patrons mm-hmm. because there's so many people that want to use our library. There is a great event coming up, and it is a screening of a documentary called Encapsulate, and that's February 11th. And that was created by a local resident, Mary Kalura. And it basically describes all the activities that surround the burying of the time capsule for 1967, which was the centennial of the village, which was recently dug up this year during the sesquicentennial. So it shows all the activities and the sort of the background story of that whole event. And she did a remarkable job. She received a grant from Orange County Arts. And so if you go to the library's website, you can get all the particulars on the date and date and time of that event. It's going to be great. I've seen it, and it's she had a original screening at the community center, so this is a secondary screening so more people can see it.
Well, hopefully it's going to be a great turnout. It sounds great to attend.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor, for giving us some of your time. Don't go away, and the Valley will be right back.
Thank you, Ryan.
Hi, I'm Peter. And there's nothing I love more than sharing vegetables with my friends.
Come on in, help yourself to anything.
That's why we give our food the utmost respect it deserves. Did you know there are simple steps we can all take to help save food? You can cook it, store it, even share it. Just don't waste it. Because when it comes to food, better ache than never. To learn more, visit SaveTheFood.com.
Welcome back. If you and your loved one love going out for movies, you'll like this. Recently for Valentine's Day, down at Grace Community Church, they held a movie for couples and families. Today's movie is Fireproof. They offered snacks such as candy, popcorn, and water. Pastor Jason Hamm started this program as a way to get people to understand themselves better and to create stronger relationships. I definitely think that is a great idea to bring people together. If you'd like to learn more about Grace Community Church, located in Warwick, please visit the website listed below. From our significant others to our furry friends, we have Stephen Mealing in Sugarloaf, New York, who has the current story on the Orange County Citizens Foundation dog adoption.
We're here today at the Adopt a Pet event at the Seligman Center in Sugarloaf, New York, which is being hosted by the Orange County Citizens Foundation and is being sponsored by the Hudson Valley SPCA. Today, there will be a showing of The Secret Life of Pets, the movie, and at the same time, there will be some adoptable rescues and pet baskets to take home if you win. Let's take a look. I'm here with Jacqueline Masterson, the brains behind the whole Adopt-A-Pet event. Jacqueline, could you tell us a little about the event today?
So everyone on staff at the Citizens Foundation love animals, and we decided since we're doing an Exploring Orange event series, we might as well include our furry friends. And so we asked Hudson Valley SPCA to join us and team up to do this friend-raising event.
That's awesome. Are there any other events going on in the Exploring Orange?
Yeah, so we're going to have a hike Sugarloaf Mountain event June 2nd. We're going to have kayak Wickham Lake event, I believe January 14th. We're also going to have bike the Heritage Trail event in May.
Now, you said you're affiliated with the Orange County Citizens Foundation. What do they do, just in a little overview?
So we are a membership-based organization, but we work towards maintaining and improving the quality of life of citizens in Orange County. So we hold forums, we hold events that help promote awareness for things. Last year we held a candidates debate for the Orange County executive debate, which you can find on our Facebook page. We have Constitutional Convention Forum to inform the citizens what they're voting on, stuff like that.
So I always bring a big dog, and I'm like, we don't know where we're going, so...
Scruffy.
Yeah, I know. For WVTV, I'm Stephen Mailing.
Thank you, Stephen. To learn more about the Citizens Foundation, check out the link posted below. Well, that's all we've got for you today. A special thank you to Michael Newhard, the Warwick Valley Historical Society, the Orange County Citizens Foundation, Grace Community Church, and the Veterans of Warwick. Tune in next time. I'm Ryan DiCostanzo, and this has been In the Valley.